So what would it take to actually build a Death Star? Hey there, crazies. You may or may not have seen it before, but there's this blog post from 2012 that asked a really fun question. How much would it cost to build the Death Star? They estimated it would cost about 850 quadrillion US dollars and would take about 830,000 years just to produce the steel. Well, that's boring. We can do better. The blog assumed the Death Star's density would be comparable to an aircraft carrier, which might make sense if present-day humans were building it. But it was built by a galactic empire a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away.
How can it be a long time ago if it's the future?
It's not the future, it's the past!
But there are spaceships!
Ugh. Imagine a group of humans from the Star Wars galaxy want to live off the grid. They venture out into intergalactic space in search of a new home. Finally, they find a remote planet with a thriving ecosystem and settle down. In an effort to shelter their children from the woes of technology, they don't pass on the stories of where they came from. Their history is forgotten. That planet they settled on is Earth, hundreds of thousands of years ago. Just go with it! Okay, so back to the aircraft carrier. Its hallways look like this, whereas hallways on the Death Star look like this. Way more room. They're like twice as tall and six times as wide. Huge! The blog chose to use the HMS Illustrious, which has a mass of 22,000 metric tons and a volume of about 28,600 cubic meters. That's over 1,000 school buses worth of space. The Death Star hallways are bigger, so it should be significantly less dense. An average of four times as much radial space gives us 64 times the volume, or 64 times less dense than the Illustrious. The first Death Star was 120 kilometers across.
Are you quoting the technical manual again? That's not canon.
Star Wars Legends is the only place I can get my data. So 120 kilometers across means it has a radius of 60 kilometers. Here's a size chart just so you can get your bearings. That's a volume of 900 trillion cubic meters. Multiplying by density, we get a mass of 11 trillion metric tons, or 11 quadrillion kilograms. That's enough to have a noticeable gravitational pull, but not nearly enough to collapse and form a solid steel sphere. Now let's estimate cost. It's really expensive to get things into space, even with a space elevator. So let's assume the steel was mined and produced in space from asteroids. There's a lot less gravity and a lot more iron. The average cost of steel on Earth in 2016 is about $400 per metric ton. The steel needed to make a Death Star would cost $4.4 quadrillion, about 57 times the gross world product. But that's just the Earth. A galactic empire is going to have a lot of planets, significantly more than 57. So I think it's safe to assume the wealth exists in the empire. But how long will it take? In the Star Wars universe, they were beginning construction at the end of Revenge of the Sith, and finished just before A New Hope. That's about 19 years or so. They'd need about 580 billion metric tons each year just to finish on time. Even with production rates like present-day Earth, it would only take 350 planet-sized mining operations to produce the steel. Totally reasonable for a galactic empire, especially if they produce faster. Although it's getting a little harder to keep this a secret. Anyway, one last thing to consider. The power source.
The Death Star is powered by kyber crystals. It's the same thing you use for the lightsabers, just way bigger.
Yes, but that needs a dose of science. Turning a planet like Earth into an asteroid field would take a lot of energy. 280 million trillion trillion joules, to be exact. That's 57 billion times the total energy ever used by human beings. Or 8.5 times the total output energy of the sun every day. For one shot. It's no surprise the Death Star requires 24 hours to recharge.
That's also not canon.
I don't care! Okay, so back to the kyber crystals. Whether they're allowing for a stable antimatter reaction, or collecting Hawking radiation from evaporating micro-black holes, or siphoning matter off the surface of a very large star like in The Force Awakens, that fuel will have a minimum mass of 3.1 quadrillion kilograms because E equals mc squared. That's a little under one-third of the mass of the steel needed to make the Death Star. I think it's safe to assume the crystals themselves don't have that much mass. The Death Star was already hard enough to move around as it was. We don't need to make it more massive. We also know they're not firing this from a different star system. It could take anywhere from 5 to 100,000 years to reach its target. So they must be collecting this mass energy at their destination and then charging for 24 hours. Wait a minute! Why are we even bothering to move a whole space station around? By calling it a station, they're saying they intend to keep it stationary. Besides, a moon-sized steel ball is going to be difficult to hide for 24 hours. Whose idea was this anyway? Wouldn't it just be easier to have the weapon separate from the station? The weapon detaches from the Death Star, goes wherever you need it to go, grabs onto a nice big asteroid, takes 24 hours to turn its mass into usable energy, and then fires. The weapon can be small, so it's easier to hide and it's a lot more mobile. At which point, why do we even need the station? It's a huge waste of time and money if all you're trying to do is build a weapon. So, do you think the Death Star was a good idea? I'd like to hear your thoughts in the comments. Thanks for liking and sharing this video, and until next time, remember, it's okay to be a little crazy.